Just can't bring this fire. church, sing it out. Church, declare, I am not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because he picked me up, because he picked me up and turned me around. He placed my feet on the solid ground. I thank the Master.
Prayer for you.
I'll sing it out.
Sunday, everyone. How are we all doing today? Good. How anointed was that praise and worship? Thank you to our music team. I will just be giving our news for today very quickly as well. So we want to welcome all of the newcomers. Yes, come sit to the front if you want to. Thank you so much. Thank you for coming to our Sunday service for today. Thank you. So just for our next week's event, we'll be having two events next week, actually. One will be our Yan Christmas party, which will be happening next Saturday on the 18th. So next week, guys, if you are in our young adults, we would love to see you there. And we know a lot of you are already coming, but if you want to invite any of your friends, they are all welcome to come. So it'll be at the Lopez residence at 5 p.m. So turn up in any of your Christmassy clothing. And there will also be a Kris Kringle that will, if you can provide a Kris Kringle, $30 max, that's the limit, and a gender neutral present for a boy or a girl, whoever you'll be getting that day. But if you want any more information, you can see our YAN leader, Sister Hazel, and as well as Ate Annika, who will be hosting for our YAN event next week. As well, for next week, we'll be having our street evangelism, which will be taking place at Sunshine Station from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. So this is going to be a big one, and if you would love to support those that will be attending, please do. You can see Sister Drew or Sister Dang, who will be the ones in charge for that event that day. So Sunshine Station, 9 a.m. to 11 a.m., same day, 18th of November. And we have another exciting announcement for our Christmas Sunday service, okay? If everyone can take this down, all right? So our Christmas Sunday service will be the 17th of December. Can you please save that date? Do not do anything that day. We did it especially on the 17th because we know people will be traveling overseas or have some plans for the Christmas weekend. So 17th of December, 10 a.m., and it will be at Campbellfield Community Center, not here. This will be closed for Christmas Day, so we decided to have it on the 17th of December, Campbellfield Community Center. So please invite your loved ones, your friends, your family to join us on this joyous occasion. It will be so much fun, and to celebrate what this year has brought us as well, all of the things that has happened to us this year. So 17th of December, please note that down, okay? And lastly, we have, if our maintenance and our ushering teams to join our briefings right after our service. We just have a quick meeting for our maintenance team. So if you help out in setting up and packing up, please join us. And also for our ushering teams, those that help coordinate everything. So that's all from me. And we'll get ready into our tithes and offering. And I hope you're ready to hear our tithes from the lovely Sister Marlene, who will be bringing in our tithes for today.
As a believer, you know that God intended the church to give tithing, yeah? Amen? So a tithe is a portion of 10% of your income. So this is, goes to your local church, amen po? Amen? So the word tithe literally means tenth in Hebrew. So in Leviticus 27:30, the Bible tells that a tenth of produce of the land, whether grain or fruit, it is the Lord's and is holy. And also in Proverbs 3, verse 9, it says that honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. It's critical to recognize that tithing is the central of God's law. Amen. Amen. So this means that the first fruit is just the biblical way of saying that you should put God first before you do anything else with your money. Amen. So the Bible explains that tithing is an important part of a faith for those who follow God, and your tithe should be money you set aside. That's why giving is the first category, because when you tithe before making plan with the rest of your money, you're making the priority to God. You're giving the first fruit instead of leftovers. Amen. So when you give to God, give it heartily. God doesn't need your money in the first place. He wants to take the greed from the heart. Amen. So it says that, why should I tithe? So the Bible tells us tithing is a way to show that we trust God with our lives and finances. And tithing isn't the benefit. He doesn't need our money instead. Amen. God doesn't need our money. He just needs our hearts. Our hearts is all he needs. Amen. Because sometimes without God, we fear God, we fear what will happen. Amen. So let's put in our hearts that when we put our tithe to the Lord, we are trusting God that God will take the rest. Amen. So that's it. And amen. So you should be giving in some way, but tithing is more spiritual than financial one. It's not about the money. As I always say, it's always in the heart. So it says in 2 Corinthians 9:7 says that each one of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Amen. When we give willingly and cheerfully, we are aligning ourselves with God's desire for us to be generous stewards of His blessings. So our giving reflects our deep love for Him and our commitments to advance His kingdom. Amen. So my question would be, we have set of goals in life. My question would be, do you have giving set of goals? Amen. So one of the great preacher in America I heard before is that when you fully trust the Lord, are you willing to fully trust your finances to God? So let's pray po. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Father God, thank you so much for this beautiful day, Panginoon, that you have bestowed unto us. Thank you for giving us all the blessings, Panginoon. Hallelujah. And Lord, we pray, Panginoon, as you fill our hearts with gratitude for the abundant blessings. Oh Lord, we acknowledge that the cheerful giving is not act of obligation, oh Lord. Hallelujah, but a joyful act of worship. Help us, oh Lord, to understand that our giving is not an expression of our, hallelujah, hallelujah, of our deep love for you and our Father, your kingdom here on earth. Lord, bless the gift and the giver, Father God. Bless your people beyond measure. And we pray, Father God, that there's going to be revival, oh Lord, in our giving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. So, I would like to introduce to you our next speaker. She's dynamic. And we are blessed to work with her in the vineyard. And she's the head of education ministry. Let's all welcome Sister Day.
Hey, Sister Martin. Thank you, music ministry. Guess he's speaker. Na-promote na naman ako. Thank you. God bless everyone. Good afternoon. And before we begin, are you excited? Yeah, ako din. I was crying before I came because I was caught in traffic in Sunshine Avenue. I had to go around St. Albans. So I wasn't crying because I'm going to be late or because I'm in the traffic. I don't know which one, but I was crying. Amen. And before we go into the Word, let's give a JIL welcome to John Calesterio Salester. Hi, good afternoon, Brother John. Welcome to church. Welcome to church. Welcome to Jesus is Lord Church. We are a non-sectarian full gospel ministry, and you can see our values and mission and vision. And this house is born in the heart of our dear brother Eddie Villanueva from the Philippines. And most of us are JIL from the Philippines, and some are also JIL Melbourneian all the way. Amen, amen. All right. Do you have your Bible with you? Yes, no, maybe. All right, as always. NIV? Anyone who reads NIV? No. What about Steve Jobs? Yes, no. Wala pa rin, Samsung. Huli na yon. Last one. Samsung, yeah, Android people. I'm not an Android lady, but it will also help. Amen. Last 2 weeks has been about revival, yeah? And our theme for the month is revival, call to action. Amen, amen. I hope you have been blessed by the last two Sundays where the history of revival in Melbourne has been introduced, and last week the principles of revival has been introduced as well. There are six principles of revival. We've tackled repentance, we've tackled prayer, right? So this today we are posturing ourselves for revival to allow God to move in the coming FY 2024, which is our theme, revival for next year, the whole JIL. Amen? Amen? So my prayer for the church, not just me, but the leadership of Melbourne, our prayer is for us not to miss it, not to miss revival. My verse for today is in Joel chapter 2, verse 13. If you have your Bible with me, can you please open to Joel 2:13? It says here, rend your hearts and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity. Amen. Let's pray. Father God in heaven, we thank you for this afternoon, O God. I pray, O God, that may we open our hearts to your word. May we render our hearts to you, Lord, and not just our garments. Lord, I pray that everything that we will be hearing today will be coming from you. Let your Holy Spirit be upon us, O God. Let your guidance be upon every word that will come out from my mouth. Lord, we thank you for this afternoon, because today we believe that you have something special for us that you will reveal to us as we prepare ourselves for the great revival coming in this world. Lord, we thank you and we honor you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. All right. So I will know if you were listening to two Sundays ago. I know you were. Some of you will remember. There were how many revivals that's happening in the world as of date? Yes, there were a lot. Specifically, there were four. So we're preparing for the fifth revival, correct? Melbourne had a great revival in 19. I know Sister Joel can answer that. She was the most excited. She couldn't contain herself. We're ready for the 100 year. So I hope you guys are ready for the 100 year revival. This is not the first heard, right? It was in Sister Anne's PowerPoint. And for me, when we saw that, we got all excited, right? It's 100 years, centenary, right? Between 1926 and year 2026 is the fourth revival, 1950s. Pastor Billy Graham, he led that revival. But so this year, in our generation, I pray to God we will pick it up. We do not know who will be the father of the fifth wave of revival, but it will happen. And my prayer to God is I don't miss it. Amen? So I took the verse from Joel 2:13, and nothing much is known about Prophet Joel. Prophet Joel is the father of, is the prophet of revival. Every prophet has their own distinctive quality. Prophet Joel is the father of, is the prophet of revival. So most of his books is written about people repenting so that God can move, so that the blessings of God can move. Last month, I talked about Prophet Amos. Prophet Amos talks about famine in the land. But what is the famine? Famine of revelation from the Lord. When there is no revelation from the Lord, the vision stops. The vision stops. So if your life, you don't have a vision, what happens? You probably need to pray, right? If in the church we don't see vision for the coming year, we will be very, very nervous. Prayer and fasting, you name it, we're going to do it. Tumbling up and down, the leaders of this house has to do whatever it takes to have the revelation from the Lord. Because vision, according to Senator Joel, is revelation from the Lord. That's how it works. Okay, amen. So, my first point is, why did God ask us to render our hearts and not our garments. Garments is our outer appearance, right? Heart is the inner being. We just sang the song, from the inside out. Render is not giving. What is the render means? Render means tearing apart, breaking it up. So God did not ask us to give your heart to me. That's not what God said. God said, render your heart to me. Break your heart for me. So the question is, are you heart broken for the Lord? Hindi po yung ano lang ha. Nakipag-break up kayo, not that, and then you got heartbroken. That's not what I mean. Alright, first point. What is the condition of our hearts? We need to have the right heart condition. In Mark 10, 19 to 27, I know you know this story. The story of the rich young ruler. Does anybody know the story? Most of us know, but I want to read verses 19 to 27. So it says here, 22. You know the commandments, do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not give false testimony, do not defraud, honor your father and mother. And he said to him, teacher, I have kept all these things from my youth. Looking at him, Jesus showed love to him and said to him, one thing you lack, go and sell all you possess and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. But he was deeply dismayed by these words, and he went away grieving, for he was one who owned much property, right? He was dismayed. Why? He was rich, but he was dismayed. Because instead of God being a priority in his life, what is his priority? His treasures, correct? I'm not saying that God doesn't want us to be rich. I'm pretty sure most of you are blessed financially. Amen? Amen? Grabe. Ninong, mamamas ko po ako next Christmas. Yung mga nag-amen dyan, alam ko na. What I'm talking about is God wants us to be blessed in all aspects of our life. Our lives, whatever. But we need to set our priorities. We need to be focused that the property or the wealth or whatever we have here is not our priority. But it comes second to God. Amen? He said in Hosea 6:1, the title of that verse is A Call to Repentance. A Call to Repentance, because Hosea is married to Gomer, a prostitute, right? And every time he goes back to prostitution, Hosea takes her back, right? Why? Because it's the love story of God to man. That every time we commit sin, God cannot be exhausted. His love for us can never be exhausted. But she died, correct? Gomer died. He was chopped into pieces and sent to the Israelites. Why? Because God said, this is my judgment. One day, God will come and judge us. I remember one of the sisters said the verse to me that in the book of Isaiah. In the book of Isaiah, it says there, at the proper time, the Lord will make it happen. Jesus is coming whether you like it or not. We just don't know when. Amen? The second point is, there is a sound. In revival, there is a sound of revival. Do we hear it? Do you hear it, church? Do you hear the sound of revival? In 1 Samuel 7:5, he says, assemble all Israel at Mizpah, and I will intercede with the Lord for you. When they had assembled at Mizpah, they drew water and poured it out before the Lord. On that day, they fasted there, and they confessed, we have sinned against the Lord. Now Samuel was serving as a leader of Israel at Mizpah. Now the Philistines heard about it,
And then they said to Samuel, the Israelites said to Samuel, "Do not stop crying out to the Lord, our God, for us, that he may rescue us from the hand of the Philistines." So there is a sound of revival. Do you hear it, church? Amen. Anyone else? Yes. This house is loud and clear. We have prayer meeting. We have upper room. We have night watch. We have dawn watch. Our brother in the East are doing a dawn watch by herself, himself. And I was telling him, "Brother, you are blessed. You heard the sound of revival." The second revival was heard all the way from Nebraska to Boston, 2,000 kilometers, five times back and forth, going to Sydney. That's how loud revival is happening. And if you do not hear it, pray that the Lord will open your ears. Because it can be heard in the Jesus is Lord Church. Even in Sydney, we can hear the dawn watchers praying. We can hear the Blacktown people prayer and fasting. And they can hear us. Our upper room in Melbourne is loud and clear. There is a sound of revival. Amen? In Acts, in the book of Acts, people are praying in the upper room until they begin to speak in tongues. And when they go out in the streets, the people in the streets heard them speaking in different language and they thought they were fools. So when people see you in the streets of Melbourne proclaiming the gospel, be prepared. Be prepared to be interrupted. Be prepared that you will look like a fool talking nonsense. Because that is revival. What is revival? Revival, again, I will just repeat, the meaning of revival is the manifestation of God's heart in the natural. Revival is not an event. Revival is not a study that you go and read in the book. It is about the heart of God. You and I, as Melbournians, we are going to be preparing for revival, so we need to be ready. Are you ready, people? Amen. Amen, I am. I'm nervous, but I am. Sunshine Revival happened in 1926. Sabi ko lang eh, pambira. 1926, and that's why I'm so excited, because we are in Sunshine, the seat of revival of Melbourne. Isn't it? Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad? You have to be, right? God positioned us where we can experience revival, right? On November 18, we're going to go out there. I don't know what's going to happen, but we're excited. Because I know when you show up, God asks you to go there. If you don't show up, maybe in the next 100 years, I don't know. Good luck. Amen? And then we go to number 3, Leap of Faith. I love this verse, Isaiah 31:4. This is what the Lord says to me. As a lion growls, a great lion, over its prey, and though a whole band of shepherds is called together against it, it is not frightened by the shouts or disturbed by the clamor. So the Lord Almighty will come down to do battle on Mount Zion and on its heights. Are you a lion, people? Maybe. We are a lion, right? We're the Lion of Judah. Come on, people. What it means, that verse means, is when we hear the voice of God, when we hear the revelation of the Lord, whatever it takes, rain, hail, or storm, we're going to do it, correct? No matter what comes your way. Why? Because God will make sure you pull it through. Because you are a lion. Remember who you are. Remember who you are. You are the Lion of Judah, right? A lion is still a lion, even in a cage. Even if you're in a difficult situation, you are still a lion. You growl. Only dogs bark, right? So if you keep yapping and talking, that's not how a lion reacts. A lion devours its enemy, right? And even if you're a single lion, don't worry about it. God got you. Amen? Amen? Amen. And I want you to, my favorite story in the Bible is in Mark 9, 14, the story of the demon-possessed boy. From childhood, he was demon-possessed that his dad would chain him in a cave so that he won't hurt himself. So one day, Jesus was coming, and he goes, Master, Master, I've already asked your disciples to apostles to pray for him, but he wouldn't get cured, right? So he said, if you can, have compassion on us and help my boy. Last night, we were in a boxing match, and in front of us was a mom who was crying when his son was in the ring, and he was heckling the crowd and us and go, oh, my son, saying his boy's name and for us to cheer for his son. She was crying. And so we were cheering for his son who won. And after that, we were talking to the dad, and he told me that it was so emotional for them because for 12 months, his son could not fight. But his first match, he won. And for me, that's what this dad is about. He's getting desperate for healing for his son, that he would do anything for him to be healed. And same thing with us, right? When the Lord finds that we are desperate for something, God will find a way. And Jesus said to him, if you can, because that's what he said, if you can, help us. Jesus said, if you can, ? Jesus was kind of confused. What are you talking about? I'm Jesus, I'm the Messiah, and your question is if I can? Of course Jesus can, right? Jesus can. So whatever you're praying for, that's the answer is yes, Jesus can. But then Jesus said, all things are possible to those who believe. Do you believe? Whatever you ask, are you asking for the Lord, do you believe? I don't know. And then in the end, the father said, Lord, I believe. Help me in my unbelief. So don't get me wrong. No matter how strong a Christian are you, there will be a point in our lives when that will be tested. And the question is, do you believe? The question is, do I believe for the things that God has for me? Elijah was a strong prophet, right? But there was a point in his life he was complaining to God, you know what, God, I'm the only one left. And God said to him, what did God say to him? There are 7,000 of my children who never bow down. So don't be asking yourself, do I need revival? Of course you do need revival. I need revival. No matter how strong you are as a believer, we all need revival. And that's our number four. We need to be hungry and thirsty for revival to be experienced in our lives. In Matthew 5-6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. What is righteousness? Is it being right or is it being wrong? Neither. Because righteousness is the posture of our hearts and an application in our lives that is received through Jesus Christ. You see, we cannot preach and not do what we preach, right? In Hosea 10:12, it says, sow righteousness for yourselves, reap up the fruit of unfailing love, and break up your unplowed ground, for it is time to seek the Lord until he comes and shower his righteousness on you. What does that mean? What does it mean to us? Break up your unplowed ground. In other translation, the word used is fallow ground. Need follow, F-A-L-L-L-O-W. Follow is hard ground. Our hearts become hardened when we keep committing sin and we are not convicted anymore. Our hearts become hardened. God said, plow the unplowed heart. You need to soften your heart so that God can plant seeds on you. Amen. A revival can only happen in a soft heart. I moved to the suburbs last year and I noticed weeds. I'm not a much of a gardener. My dad is. So everything in my house, the coquette tree, calamansi, all those fruits, he cleared it out when he was alive. And I remember dad making sure it's clean, flower plants everywhere. But when I got there after how many years, 10, 12 years, it's not the same. And for me, weeds are growing. The problem with us is when we become complacent, when we become indifferent. You come to church, do your praise and worship, listen to the word, but you go home indifferent. You do not concern yourself anymore with the other things that you see in the house of God or other people. You know, as long as I'm not hurting him or her, I'm okay. Indifferent allows weeds to grow in our hearts. You stop caring. We stop caring for the lost souls. We are contented coming here every single Sunday that when you go outside, you don't see those people are hurting. God said this is the year of the Lord's favor in Isaiah 61. I will send you to the broken. I will put my spirit on you so you can heal what? The brokenhearted. Our people are hurting, but what do you do when people go to you? Do you heal them? Or do you tell them, I will pray for you? You know what I don't want to hear all the time is, you know, Sister Deng, God is sovereign. I know God is sovereign. But right now, I need comfort, right? And you will tell me God is sovereign? Seriously? God is sovereign no matter what. He is sovereign. But the only way the sovereignty of God can be felt is if you and I learn how to open the ground for God to make a move. Revival precedes, prayer precedes revival. And revival precedes the hand of God. So it doesn't happen like when you get revival, you get blessed. No, revival has to happen first so that God can move. That's why we're very loud that our hearts need to be revived. Baka po yung iba sa atin, most of us, if we're in the ICU situation, I'm calling all the nurses in the house. Amen? Don't make, you know, your ambition is not to be treated in the ICU so that God can revive you. Defibrillator all the way, right? Before you get there, examine our ways. Sow righteousness. Remove the weeds. Make your land, make your heart arable so that God can plant good seeds, good dreams, right? If there's one thing that my dad, I'm going to share this, I always remember how my first adult conversation with dad is going to college. I wanted to do law and I wanted to take political science. He sat me down and talked to me and said, think it wisely, 8 years. Are you willing to study 8 years of your life just in studying? Consider accounting, because if you get tired or, you know, something else happened, you are an accountant. So I didn't become a lawyer, but I became an accountant. And it's good. Now I'm kind of asking myself, maybe dad hoaxed me to become an accountant to be a continuation of his life. But I don't care anymore, because for me, that conversation was sown to me when I was 16, and I would still remember that whenever I make a major decision, consider the future. Your vision has to be not just now, you have to look beyond now. For those of you who got married, I remember my mom saying to my brother, you're getting married. That's all she said. Make sure you have a wider vision, and that's it. And of course, we don't know what it means, right? Even my brother doesn't know, but that's all mom said. And the following day was his wedding day. I don't know what he did now, but I'm all right. I think he's okay. Amen? In Hebrews 3:13, it says, exhort one another every day as long as it is called today, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of your sin. Love the people around you, because they are the one who will tell you if you're doing things away from the Lord. If you're doing things away from the Lord, the people around you will remind you. Last last week I was talking to my best friend, and I just got reminded, I'm so busy with the things in Australia, doing the ministry, doing my job. We call ourselves loaded in the life group. In our life group, we call ourselves loaded because we're supposed to finish at 8:30. We never get to 8:30. We always go past 8:30, right? And if revival is happening, I think, having said that, I don't know if it's going to happen or not, but yeah, we're loaded. Revival is for the one whose faith is winning, right? It's dying. But last week, I was reminded of my best friend, and I realized that for a very long time, we didn't talk, for around 6 months. And I cried after that conversation because I said to God, she's my best friend. I've known her since I was a kid. I'm so busy with your work, with the work of the ministry. I'm so busy with my family. But I forget the people who will love me no matter what. She will never go without me. Like, even if we don't talk much, she will still be my best friend, right? But I realized that time, I spend more time with other people, not my best friend. It's not wrong. But my question to you is, do you do that to people? If you don't, thank you. You're good. But I realize, you know, God, you need to revive me, because these people, the people that love me without condition, are the ones that I overlooked, that I want, the ones that I took for granted. And I said to God, maybe it's time that I be a good best friend as well. And I encourage you people to love the people that you are with right now, especially the ones who were with you from the beginning. They will not go anywhere. The relationship you have with them will not be erased. No matter what happened, you will have that portion of your life, that part of your life will be there forever. Because at the moment in time, you were with that person, and no one can replace that. So for me, it was an eye-opening for me, an eye-opener, because God reminded me that I put a lot of people in your life. But how many people have you shared the word? How many people knows me through you? And no matter how loaded I am in the ministry, how many revelation he gave to me, I still need revival. I still need revival. You know, in the beginning, my thoughts were, God, do I need revival? We were laughing about it. But when I got home, I prayed to God. I don't want to be arrogant, Lord, but I want to know if I need to be revived. Knowing your word is not enough. Having the compassion to go to the street of sunshine to be saved is not enough. But having the people in your life that you took for granted and did not share the word, one day it will be your accountability. Can you face God and say, you have done everything? Yes, you have saved multitudes outside your house. But what about the people in your house? Your brother, your sister, your brother-in-law, your sister-in-law. Are they saved? That's the question. So for me, the measure of revival is not how good you are in the ministry, how close you are in the Lord. It's your heart. If it is still beating, the heartbeat of God, does it still beat for the heart of God to be with the people that he loves, to save the lost soul? In Isaiah 54, 14 to 15, and I will end here. Build up, prepare the road, remove the obstacle out of the way of my people. For this is what the high and exalted one says. He who lives forever, whose name is holy. I live in a high and holy place, but also with the one who is contrite and lowly in spirit, to revive the spirit of the lowly and to revive the heart of the contrite. What is contrite? Contrite means penitent, humbled by our own sins and failures, seeking after God. It is not about your sin alone, but it is also about your failures. You need to reflect. There are many things that I failed in. I don't just fail. I reflect so I can do better. God said, I will live in the heart of a contrite person. You don't need to be perfect. You just need to have a heart for the Lord. Having that in your life, I ask you now, church, do you need revival? Do you need revival? And if you don't know the answer, revival is coming whether you like it or not. The question is, where will you be when it comes? Where will you be? Are you gonna be on the side of the road? Or are you gonna be in the middle? So that when revival comes in, you catch everything. You and I are called to the ministry of God. To what? Not to evaluate, not to assess, but we are called to engage. We are called to participate, even if it's just a simple prayer every day for the house of God, for Jesus is Lord Church worldwide, especially for the Jesus is Lord Church Melbourne. You know, it's enough. God is not asking a lot, but He is asking your heart to beat just one beat for the heart of Melbourne so He can sow in our church. There's so many prayers this house wants and is asking for the Lord. I pray that you hear the sound. You hear the sound. We do not wake up in the middle of the night to pray for this house because we cannot sleep. We pray because we know it's what God wants us to do. I will bother my brothers and sisters at midnight to wake up and pray because we need you. Even the dawn watchers, even in his lone time, the only one I know in Melbourne who wakes up. I said to him, brother, you're blessed. I didn't know he was praying, but when he said it to us in our group, I was jumping for joy, and he is from the east, the Lone Ranger from the east. So for me, I believe with all my heart, revival is in the house of Melbourne, and you will hear it in this time. Amen. Amen. And we stand to our feet.
Come on, let's rise up and continue in the presence of God. Hallelujah. Sing a song. In my heart and my soul.
Thank you. your message, oh God. I pray, oh God, that you touch each and every one of us here, and we will not question whether we need revival or not, because we know and we believe that when our hearts are ready for you, Lord, revival will come, and you can do your moves in the house of Jesus' Lord Church first, and then in the community of Sunshine, and then in the community of Australia, oh God. Lord, I pray that revival will start in our house, in our own household, oh God. And Lord, we thank you for every single day that you allow us to be in your presence, Lord. And Lord, when our time has come and you haven't come yet, may our generation prepare the way for the next generation. Lord, we thank you for the generation that come before us. We stood in the platform that they left for us. I pray, oh God, that this generation will prepare the platform where you will stand, oh God, and fulfill the promises that you have for the world, oh God, the one that you love. And Lord, when our personal time to serve you is over and our lights are dimming, may we always find you as our light in our dark moments, in our personal life, oh God. I pray that you will call us to get out of our cave and be in our mountaintop, and remember that we are the Lion of Judah, the one that you love, the one that you esteem, Lord. I pray that you will always bless the works of our hands. And most importantly, Lord, I pray that we will have a heart only broken for you, so that you can plant the seeds that needs to be there for your hand to move in our lives. Lord, I pray for all my brothers and sisters who are here today, oh God, that let them hear the sound of revival, oh God. There is a sound, and it's calling us. And for all the prayer warriors in the house of God, Lord, you will call this house the house of prayer. Our prayers will be heard, Lord. Our prayers will be heard in heaven. In our unbelief, Lord, teach us to believe. Help us to believe. Lord, we thank you for every single soul that you will let pass this church. May we never forget them and show them your love, the love that you have for them. Lord, thank you for this opportunity. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah. Sino ang pinagpala sa asong amoy?
Amen. Woo! Praise the Lord.
Oh, give him praise. Give him praise. Give him praise. Hallelujah. Let's shout a victory.
Feet on the sun, ground, I think the master. limitations are nothing is so hard for you, Lord God. Lord, you are infinite. You are unchanging, Lord God. Lord, thank you for the message today, Lord God. Thank you for the message of revival, Lord God. Lord, we claim, Lord God, as we seen in the slide, Lord God, 1926 revival in Sunshine, Lord God. Lord, we pray that you will engage us, Lord God, to participate in the 100 years of revival, Lord God, in Sunshine, Melbourne, Lord God. Lord, we thank you, Lord God, for the life of Sister Deng, Lord God. Lord, she is a blessing to us in JIL Melbourne, Lord God. Lord, we pray that you bless her life, Lord God. We pray, oh God, that you'll give her the desires of her heart, Lord God. And Lord, we also pray for our evangelism, Lord God, on Saturday, Lord God. Lord, you are the one who choose people to for the seeds. You bring people to water those seeds, and you are the one who give us the harvest, Lord God. Lord, we pray on Saturday, Lord God, that you will bring people, Lord God, and prepare us, Lord God, who are called by you, Lord God, to share your gospel, Lord God. And Lord, we pray, oh God, that as we have this revival, Lord God, Lord, we pray that you give us the right condition of our hearts, Lord God. Reveal to us, Lord God, the things which are undesirable to you, Lord God. Lord, we pray, oh God, that we will be like lions of Judah, Lord God, that whatever the circumstances, Lord God, we will stand by you, Lord God. Lord, we pray for revival that transform life, Lord God. And Lord, we pray that we will always have hunger and thirst for your word, Lord God. And Lord, we pray that we will have passion, Lord God, to share your word for the lost soul. Lord, we pray that that our hearts will beat like yours, Lord God. And Lord, we pray that we'll be able to share the gospel, Lord God. Lord, for this coming week, Lord God, we pray, oh God, for your people, Lord God. Lord, we continuously pray for your presence, Lord God, for your miracles, Lord God, for your passion, Lord God, for us, Lord God. Lord, we bring you back all the glory and praises in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.